Endurance athletes become skilled at intercepting the body's messages to the brain. Mark Allen is one of the best at ignoring his own distress signals. If you tell your body something long enough, it believes you. But from the outside, your opponents see what you won't admit. And when Scott and Allen got a good long look at each other near the turnaround, what Dave Scott saw gave him inspiration. Mark Allen was approaching the wall, and the next water stop was irresistible. Fire in his eyes, still thinking, still planning.
One guy, he's walking up there. He's walking, Dave. Let's go. Hey, Scott. Woo! Yeah!
You got him, Dave.
To go. Dave Scott slips by a walking Mark Allen under cover of a pace car. Mark Allen never sees him. It was a calculated move by Scott, just in case Allen was capable of taking an eight count on the cone of blacktop and then duking it out again in the final miles.
But Allen, who ran to victory in Dallas and France and Japan and Australia, Allen, the man on the cereal box, Mr. Triathlon, now knew that he was back in the Ironman, back on Dave Scott's turf. The final 4 miles would give Mark more than enough time to wonder why. Why was he invincible around the world, everywhere? Everywhere except here, where Dave Scott was king of the long, hot road. Mark looked okay as he came to the finish, but he really wasn't. Taken to the medical tent, he was pumped with 3 liters of glucose solution. He didn't respond. He had to be rushed to the hospital, where he was found to be severely dehydrated and bleeding internally. Mark Allen would return to race another day. But on this particular day, he had not only given his all, he had given more than he had to give.
What was it going to take? I'd done 125 Ironmans worth of training, and that was not enough. I couldn't do much more than that without killing myself. What made Dave Scott so effective? He trained a lot less than me, and he was walking away as a champion. Now, every single person in this building has had to deal with setbacks, with points in their lives where they felt like I did the right kind of work, but I fell short of my goals. But that's really just a test of our commitment of completion, isn't it? Are we just going to give up? Or are we going to stand back up, make the adjustments necessary, and take our dreams all the way to completion? But I was devastated by that setback. The following year, I came back to the Ironman, but I didn't change anything about my training. And you know the old saying, if we keep doing what we've been doing, we're going to get more of what we already had. And that was not satisfying. In my 6th Ironman, I finished in 5th place, farther out of the lead than any of my other finishes there in Hawaii. I was at a crossroads. My family, my friends, the press, everybody was saying, you know what, Mark, you can beat Dave Scott elsewhere. You can win races in other places. Don't go back. You're not cut out for this. This is a test of completion, isn't it? Where is that vision? Where is that dream? What will carry us forward when we have these crossroad moments? And I reflected and I realized, you know what? I don't know if I can be the champ, But I know that walking the marathon is not my best race. I need to go back at least one more time and try to have my best performance. But I certainly need to do something different. And this is where I had to employ those three tools that I talked about in the very beginning. Now, if things aren't working out, there really are only two general kinds of adjustments we can make. One is to change the way we actually do our work, and the other is to ask ourselves, what is it about me as a person that might be holding me back from the success that I am after? Now, the how we do our work part is very industry specific. I had to get a little faster at swimming, cycling, and running. Those are probably not skills that will help you directly in the financial services industry. But the what is it that holds me back part, those are things that can affect us regardless of the challenge. Maybe we're afraid. Maybe we have self-doubt in the tough moments. Maybe that mental chatter starts up when we really need a quiet, clear mind, and we need ways to work with that. But I didn't want to look in here first. First, I looked at the logbook and I said, you know what? My longest training day is 6 hours, but the Ironman takes 8, and I'm falling apart in those final 2 hours of the race. So as I prepared for my 7th Ironman, I designed 5 Ironman training days where I would swim 30 minutes, get out of the water, bike 7 hours, get off of my bike, and run 30 minutes. That's an 8-hour training day. That's the kind of work that the Ironman wants me to do to become the champion. Those 5 days, they only added 10 extra hours onto my entire training year. That's less than 2 minutes a day. Would you be willing to work less than 2 minutes a day, if done in the right way, to achieve the greatest dream you have for your life? Absolutely, yeah. But I knew that I still had to ask myself, what is it about me as a person that's holding me back here? And so I just reflected on the Ironman, and I realized I was afraid of that race. I was afraid of the wind on the bike that can be a headwind all the way out to the turnaround, and then when I see that sign that says turnaround, so does the wind, it turns around, and you have a headwind all the way back. That scares me. I was afraid of the heat on the marathon. I ended up in the hospital because of it, and I was afraid of Dave Scott. I could not see myself winning unless he had a bad race, but there was no way Dave Scott was going to have a bad race in Hawaii, short of me whacking him in the kneecaps with a pipe. No. So I did bike rides into the wind to show myself, I can take that, I can do that, I don't have to be afraid of that. I did my long runs in the middle of the day, not in the morning or the evening when it's cooler. My training partners hated me, but I said, this is the work we need to do if we're going to have our best Ironman in October. And I practiced, at least in my mind, what I was going to say to Dave Scott when I saw him at the start. Dave, I hope you have your best race this year because I'm going to beat you. Now, that was easy to say in my living room in January, but I knew in October he would be the toughest challenge. 5 minutes to 7, my 7th Ironman was going to be starting. I spotted Dave Scott warming up. I backstroked over to him, pretending like I didn't see him. I got right next to him. I turned over, and I go, oh, Dave, have a great race. And I stuck with him like glue. The cannon sounded. We headed out for 2.4 miles of swimming. I stayed on his feet the entire swim course. Every 3 or 4 minutes, I would just tap his foot to let him know I was back there. I knew he hated that. We biked through incredible headwinds within sight of each other. We started the marathon once again side by side. Around the half marathon point, we passed once again the final person who had been ahead of us, and we were on a pace that was going to shatter the world's record. But Dave was the stronger of us, and he dropped his pace down to a 6-minute mile, and he held it mile after mile after mile, and my mind began to go crazy with all the kind of stuff that doesn't help you out. Ah, Dave, he's so strong. There's no way I can win this thing. I didn't do the right kind of training. I just want to quit. I am such a loser. Telling yourself you are a loser does not fortify you with the strength you need to become a champion. Finally, it got so difficult to match his pace that I couldn't even hold on to the negative thoughts. And then the most amazing transformation took place. You see, in moments like that, the only thing we can change are the thoughts we tell ourselves, isn't it? It was too late for me to go back and ask myself, should I have done more training or less training? It was certainly too late to ask myself, should I have rinsed my cottage cheese? But my mind went quiet. Something happened. You see, 2 days before the race, I was flipping through a magazine, just passing time, not reading what was there, until one page caught my attention. It was an advertisement for a workshop that was going to take place in Mexico, teaching about a way of life from the Indians in that area, the Huichol Indians. And I would later learn that the Huichol Indians have a saying that says, it's not over until it's over, meaning no matter how impossible our dreams or goals look right now, take that next step because it might come around for you. Keep taking that next step until you do realize those dreams that you have for yourself. I would also learn that the Huichol Indians value the ability to quiet their minds. They say, when our minds are quiet, then we get the answers to the big questions in life. In fact, Albert Einstein admitted, he said, the most amazing insights he received often came to him when he was riding a bicycle, when he was just daydreaming. Great goals happen with a lot of work and also a little bit of daydreaming, don't they? Well, anyway, what caught my attention in this ad was the two great shamans or medicine men that were going to lead this workshop. One was a 110-year-old Huichol Indian, Don Jose, and the other was his adopted grandson, Brant Secunda. And they had a look on their face that said, I am happy just to be alive. You know how that is when you wake up in the morning and you are happy just to get up and jump out of bed? You know that no matter how chaotic the day is, it's going to be a good day. You're going to be able to deal with everything that happens and comes across your path. And with that happiness, you're bringing positive energy. Fear, doubt, stress melts away, and you bring everything positive that you have into that endeavor. Well, I needed that in that moment when Dave Scott was breaking me mentally. Finally, my mind went quiet. Don Jose's image came back to me, and suddenly, I was happy to be there. I mean, I was next to the best guy in the sport. There were still 13 miles to go in the marathon. Something might change, and my energy began to come back. Let's take a look at this next video as the entire dynamic of the race begins to shift.
Mark Allen needs this victory to fulfill the life he has devoted so totally to this sport. But to win, he must take something from Dave Scott, Scott's identity almost. Scott's job is to stop him. The leaders, with 14 miles to go, a desolate scene evoking the sense of loneliness inherent in this sport in which the long hours of training require such self-absorption. Underscoring this, it is interesting to note that Mark Allen and Dave Scott have not exchanged a word since this race began.
With neither man giving in, Dave and Mark have driven each other to another plateau. They are once again averaging an incredible 6 minutes per mile. It is clear that Scott's three-year-old Ironman record will be broken. The only question, who will break it?
2 miles to go. This is the final uphill on the course. Looking back, Allen has made a move, and Scott appears unable to answer it. In 1982, Mark Allen couldn't finish. In 83, he was third. In 84, fifth. In 86 and 87, he was second. In 88, fifth. And finally now, in his seventh Ironman, for Mark Allen, the long quest for victory is over.
Dave Scott had his best Ironman ever in his career that day. He beat his previous world's record by almost 17 minutes. I did my best time on that day by nearly 30, and the difference in our times at the end was a mere 58 seconds. A very small difference on a very long day. I went on to win five straight Ironman titles from 1989 through 1993. In 1994, I took time away from Ironman racing because we had the birth of our son, and I wanted to just have a little more time to figure out what that meant to be a father. Also in 94, I was burned out. Has anybody ever been burned out in this room here? Oh, two of you. But by 1995, I was charged up and I was ready to come back one more time. Securing the future and living the dream requires, when we set out on big endeavors, that again, we have a clear vision of where it is that we're going and why that has meaning to us. And there was one reason that I wanted to come back that had meaning to me. You see, Dave Scott, during his career, had won six Ironman titles. I was at five. Hey. If I could come back and win one more, I would tie the record that represented the best our sport had to offer. But in 1995, I was 37 years old, which in your industry is not old, but as an endurance athlete, I was ancient. I was a fossil. And all the young guys, 10, 15 years younger than me, heard that I was coming back. They go, come on, Mark, we're going to chew you up and spit you out all over the lava. You see, as a 37-year-old, I could no longer do the training that I had done that had won me those other Ironman victories. I had to make some major adjustments and shifts in the balance of how I did my work. On any given day, I could only do between 25 and 50. I had to do 25 to 50% less training than I had done previously if I was going to have any hope of getting to that start line healthy. Have you ever been asked to do the same or better results with 25 to 50% less resources available to you? You know kind of what I'm talking about here? Where was I going to get that extra? I had met Brant Secunda, the adopted grandson of Don Jose, 5 years earlier and started to learn what gave those two great men that zest for life that said, I'm happy to be alive. And he helped me to develop that ability to quiet my mind, to be more stable under pressure, to bring more positive energy into everything that I was doing. And I was hoping that would be what would help me out. I had also done everything technologically to be faster. I found a material that had less drag in the water than our skin, and I had Nike make me a suit out of this material, which unfortunately didn't arrive until 2 days before the race, and the package came, I unzipped it, I pulled it out, and I go, uh-oh, big problem here. You see, this didn't have the fine styling that the Olympic swimmers had in their suits that you've seen in the last few Olympics. This thing looked like it was dragged out of my wife's side of the closet. I was totally embarrassed to wear this thing, but I was willing to risk embarrassment if it meant I could be the champion. I had found a lacing system that would save me 10 seconds in transition from bike to run. It went on my running shoes. It was free time. Why not? My final Ironman, I thought I had it all together, but when I came off the bike, I was in fifth place, and I was 13 and a half minutes behind the leader, a guy who was 24 years old, 13 years younger than me. And as I was putting on my running shoes, I didn't really know what the gap was at that point, but somebody yelled out, they go, he's 13 and a half minutes ahead of you, go catch him. And I'm thinking, gee, I just saved 10 seconds. I was trying to keep a positive attitude because I knew if the negative thoughts came in, forget it, it wasn't going to happen. There's thousands of people cheering as you exit the bike to run transition area. When I got to the top of the first hill, there were three old ladies who were looking right at me, and they go, oh, go Mark, go Mark, go Mark. Ah, he doesn't look so good. And that thought sunk in, and about a mile later, I felt so bad, I didn't know if I was even going to be able to finish. And then all the negative thoughts came in. Ah, the guy who's ahead of me, his name was Thomas Hellriegel. Hellriegel, he's so far ahead, there's no way I can catch that guy. I should never have raced here this year. I should have called it quits at five. Hey, there's a hotel, just call it a day. If we quit, there is no chance of completion, is there? Even if we just kind of show up, but we don't put all of our energy into it, there is no chance of completion. But finally, I got my mind to be quiet, and then the answer came. Take it to the finish line. Get to that finish line. And I thought, yeah, you know what? The way I feel, that would be a success on this day if I could get there. I said, no matter what it takes, I got into this sport to cross the finish line. This is my final Ironman. I'm going to give it everything I have, even if I have to walk every step of this marathon. And in the instant I said, I will do what it takes to get to that finish line. The guy in fourth place, 10 seconds ahead of me, stopped. He stretched his back. I made the first pass, and suddenly the whole world of opportunity began to open back up. I went from fifth to fourth to third, and then I moved myself into second place. With 8 miles to go in the marathon, I was told that I was 4 minutes behind Thomas Hellriegel. Now, at the beginning of that marathon, I had to make up 30 seconds a mile, every single mile, if I was going to catch him at the finish line. I was on pace to do that, but the finish line is not a good place to catch a guy who's 13 years younger than you when you're sprinting for the victory. And once again, my mind was just going crazy. Ah, Hellriegel, I can't even see the guy. I don't have it, what it takes. I just need something, but I can't find it. Where do you find the answers when you can't find them? Finally, I got my mind to be quiet, and then it came. Give 100% of what you have to give. 100%. And I thought, I am. My legs are killing me. I have blisters on my feet. And then I thought, wait a minute. You know what? I am holding back just a little bit. You see, I was waiting for some imaginary billboard to pop out of the lava that said, Mark, if you give 100% of what you have to give, I guarantee you're going to win this race. And those type of guarantees do not exist in the real world, do they? So I just drew all my attention away from that guy that had been leading the race for 6 hours, and I said, no matter what, I'm going to give everything I have. And I called out to the island. I said, help me here. The mile after that, I made up 40 seconds on Thomas Hellriegel. And the mile after that, a little over 50. The one after that, I made up a minute 15 on the guy who was leading the race for 6 hours and who was still 13 years younger than me. Finally, at mile 20, I could see him in the distance. He looked tiny, but I could see him. And 3 miles later, I was on his back, hoping to make the final pass of my Ironman career. So let me show you this closing video as I move in on the toughest competitor I ever had to compete against.
The Energy Lab, its very name, often a misnomer, can be the watershed for the bravest of athletes. Thomas Hellriegel is experiencing the loneliest day of his life, and now he faces up for the first time to the man who is haunting him. Mark Allen was once almost 14 minutes back. Like a robot in perfect control of his functions, Allen has moved in. He's just 3.5 minutes behind. This race is down to just two men. The brave German attacked in the bike ride to have any chance of winning. But for the first time in 7 hours, his body is objecting to the torture.
Mark Allen has chased Thomas Hellriegel for nearly 6 hours with patience few of us know. Cat and mouse means cunning, tortoise and hare slow and steady, fox and hound respect and eventual victory. They're all alive right here on a road called Queen K. Mark Allen's done much in his career, but nothing equals this. Barring the unimaginable, Mark Allen has just pulled off the greatest comeback in the history of this event. A lot of people questioned his return after a year off, and people do become beatable someday, don't they? Well, they all gave it their best shot. Hellriegel, Zach, Mueller, later Welch, and they all failed. 6 Ironman championships. That'll tie the men's record of Dave Scott. And if this is Allen's final Ironman, he is leaving on top of the game. He said that in every other Ironman he's run, he ran out of anger, feeling he had to prove something or to fill some hole in his life. He said this is the first one he's run for himself. Some things change when you become a father. Some things remain the same. Mark Allen is the 1995 Gatorade Ironman Champion.
All right, let's hear it for the old guys, huh? Thank you. I beat Hal Riegel by about 2.5 minutes, which if you figure as a percent of the total amount of time we race each other, the difference in our times was less than 0.5%. Again, a very small difference. As you heard through my stories, I got into the sport just with the dream to cross the finish line, but that changed when I was willing to do the work the Ironman was asking me to do to accomplish that success. And I finally, in 1989, won the first of those victories. And then the final victory came when I was able to pass that toughest test any of us can of completion. Are we willing to give 100% of what we have to give, even if it might look impossible to achieve our dreams? So I invite you to use these tools in your life. Don't take my word for it that they can work. What's the work that your goals are asking you to do this year to achieve them? What are your 5 Ironman training days going to look like? What are your 2 extra minutes a day going to look like for you? Be willing to make those adjustments necessary to be truly effective and successful, not only in the way you do your work, but take the time to develop your inner strength, your inner character, so that you can bring more of you into this endeavor that you're putting your efforts into at Northwestern. And also, have that absolute commitment to completion, to sticking it out, taking that next step, even in the tough and impossible-looking moments. Because remember, impossible is just a solution that has yet to present itself. Thank you very much, Northwestern Mutual. Good luck. We'll see you again soon. Thank you. Woo.
Another round of applause for Mark Allen.